Mr. Tarrou, welcome back. Okay, in statistics today, we're going to talk about experimental designs. And if you're watching these videos because you're taking an AP stats class, the chapter in your book about sampling designs and experimental designs may only be two sections like mine is. Now, don't let that fool you. If you go to the apcentral.collegeboard.com site and you look up the old sample responses, open-ended responses from all of the past years, the second or third question is always about asking you to design or describe how you would design an experiment or a sample. That is extremely important. If we cannot collect good data, no matter what we do mathematically to it, it'll still be biased and therefore no good. So pay special attention to these problems and these notes. Make sure you read the examples in your textbook, and it wouldn't be a bad idea to go to apcentral.collegeboard.com and find those PDF files of the old tests, the old open-ended response questions, so that you can look at those responses as well, the samples that they've offered from students. Okay, experimental design. We are going to be experimenting on the units, or people don't like to be thought of as a number, so we'll call those subjects. An applied experimental condition is called a treatment, and whenever you're given a question about is this an observational study or an experiment, please remember to just simply identify whether a treatment is imposed or not. If there's no treatment imposed, it's an observational study. Explanatory variables are called factors. So let's talk about medical studies. If you're trying to test a new headache drug given, maybe giving somebody just a placebo like a sugar pill, aspirin, Tylenol, and then ibuprofen, those would all be the different factors. Now, if you want to test, and this is a little bit confusing with some of the questions in the book, if you're going to then start using like, okay, I'm going to use 5, 10, and 20 milligrams of a particular drug, those varying levels of that particular factor, well, I just used the word I'm trying to define, those are levels, those varying factors of a particular factor are going to be identified as levels. And again, that will be different drug doses. In principle, since you can control the effects of lurking variables, experiments give very good evidence for causation. If you cannot set up an experiment, there are five characteristics that you must take a look at to show evidence of causation. But an experimental design with your control of over all the lurking variables, that's your simplest way of attempting to prove causation, that one explanatory variable is truly maybe not necessarily the only variable, but that's what we try and minimize it down to with intro to stats, where that one variable is what's causing the change in the response variable. Okay, first page of the notes, moving on. Okay, we're going to take a look at three principles of experimental designs. And if you are in a lot of science classes and you're doing labs, you could very well already know these three principles. You need a control or a control group. A control group is given no treatment such as a placebo, but don't leave it at just that, or a known treatment. If you're testing a new drug, again, medical study, and you are dealing with patients that have a life-threatening illness, such as heart disease, you cannot give the control group a sugar pill and say, yes, I'm treating you for heart disease, and in the background know, okay, well, drug B is just a sugar pill, and we're not really giving them a treatment. Let's see if they have a placebo effect and start feeling better. No, you don't want to kill your patients. So a control group is just another group getting a known treatment, a known, drug in this case. Okay, comparisons of several treatments in the same environment is the simplest form of control, and that's what I'm talking about where you're given a known, in medical studies, like a known drug or a known treatment or a no treatment, a placebo, and then whatever that treatment is you're dealing with. Okay, and a placebo effect. Now, say we're talking about alcohol in the blood level. Blood levels of alcohol based on how much you drink. If you want to see if maybe taking aspirin or eating affects your body's absorption of alcohol, I don't think that there's a possibility of having a placebo effect on alcohol in your blood, or if you're doing an experiment on an inanimate object, maybe you're sealing plastic bags and seeing what temperature is best, you're not going to have any placebo effect there. But maybe if you're doing, let's say, pain relief or headache relief, and you could certainly give somebody a placebo for headaches, and then maybe them just thinking, okay, I took something, it should make me feel better, and all of a sudden the body just sort of starts to relax and sort of maybe the headache is relieved just from that placebo effect of thinking that you're getting a treatment. The second principle of experimental design is replication, using enough subjects to reduce chance variation. You would not trust an experiment done on one or two subjects. Larger samples, experiments, are more accurate. I would not trust a medical study that was only done on five individuals. Just like in a much simpler setting, if I give you a coin, if someone gave me a coin and said, is this coin fair? I wouldn't flip it twice and get, oh, I got heads twice, so this coin is unfair. Head shows up 100% of the time. You only flipped it twice, you only did two trials. That's not large enough to be accurate. So you need replication. You need a good sized sample in your experiment to have accurate results. And I'm going to shut a window before we move on to the next pane of notes. Okay, moving on. Okay. No. There we go. Okay. Randomization in an experiment. The third and final good principle of experimental design. Randomization. You use a rule to assign the experimental units to treatments. Helps to eliminate bias in the results. The mathematical basis of statistics is the study of probabilities, and probabilities is the study of random behavior. If you do not have randomness in your experiment, in your data, there's no mathematical basis for the mathematics of probability. Plus, our brains, you know, they work on patterns. I've heard it said that we perceive depth perception because we live in a world built with, a lot of rectangular shapes. And the way those angles of those corners change help us perceive depth. So if you just mentally say, well, I'm going to pick you, and you. I mean, it may seem random, but a lot of times that will bring in bias just because of how our minds work into the experiment or data. So you do want randomness. I got 100 patients, I want to randomly assign them to two groups. Okay, I'll flip a coin. Heads, you're in group one. Tails, you're in group two. Tails, you're in group two. And then, of course, you know, when one group gets about half the patients or the subjects, then whoever's left is going to be the other half. Or put all the names in the hat and pull them out one by one, and the first 50 get treatment one, the next 50 get treatment two, and so on. Or use your random digit table or a number generator from your calculator to assign people or things to treatments. Of course, if you're assigning people or things to treatments and you're using a random number generator, you cannot use those repeat numbers. You cannot put the same unit or subject into a treatment twice or even two different treatments. So we do need some randomization, and when you do your description of randomization, make sure that you say that if you're going to use a random number, that it's the first X number of unique values get treatment whatever, treatment one, treatment two. This concept, statistical significance, is a massively important concept as soon as we're getting fairly close to all of our building blocks of statistics, and in a couple of chapters, we're going to start finally being given full, complete, sort of real-life data statistical settings that we have to read it, just know how to set it up, know how to set up our hypothesis, and then run a test and draw a conclusion at the end. Statistical significance as a definition is going to be how we draw our conclusions at the end of our data analysis. So let's see what it says. An observed effect is so large that it would rarely occur by chance. And I'm a little bit wary about this verbiage, observed effect is so large. If you flip a coin, you know you're not going to get 50% heads every single time. You'll be around 50% with that sampling distribution if the coin is indeed fair. But if you have if you flip a coin and you get 45% heads or 52% heads, you're not going to be very surprised about that. And that sampling mean or proportion not equaling exactly the population proportion is normal. That's not surprising at all. So what we're looking at is the probability of that event occurring. So I've made an example where the observed effect is the same, the difference is the same. A new cholesterol drug lowers cholesterol by 10 points. If the probability of that decrease of 10 points or more, remember when we find areas under a bell curve, when we find probabilities, it's a continuous random variable. So we can only find probabilities of inequalities. So it's 10 points or more. You could shade to the left as well, but if we're talking about a new cholesterol drug and we want that new cholesterol drug to, of course, lower cholesterol more than maybe a previous one, then we want that difference to be as much as possible. So we're probably shading to the right in those bell curve calculations. I'm not doing an example right now because I just want to talk about the concept. If the probability of that observed difference or more is 30%, well then so what? I mean, an event occurring one third of the time, that's pretty likely, one out of three times. So the probability, the difference that you observed of 10 points, you might go, well that wasn't zero, so the new drug was better, but it had a 30% or 33% chance of occurring. That is a very likely outcome. If you tell me something is true and that it happens, I'm not going to be surprised. That's what should have happened. Now, if maybe it was a larger sample, so it had a smaller standard deviation, or maybe just the data was less varied to begin with, whatever. If the probability of your observed difference of 10 or more only had a 1% chance of occurring, well now, see now you observed a difference, and it was a difference that when we did a z-score calculation and found the area under the bell curve had a very small probability of occurring. Well, why did that event occur that was so unlikely? Well, it could be by chance. People do win the lottery. But with statistics, we have to go with what's more likely, what's more probable. Well, if an event occurred that was very unlikely, well, let me just read what I wrote. The probability of this drop is 1%. So the observation is probably due to the effectiveness of the drug and not simply by random chance. So the more unlikely an event occurs, you know, if when we talk about setting up hypothesis, H sub O and H sub A later this year, you'll know that when you set up an experiment, you'll assume that the treatment had no effect. And as when, with that assumption of no effect, we did get one. And we got one that was very, very, very unlikely to occur. So that unlikeliness in the randomness of the numbers means that it probably occurred instead because the drug was more effective. Statistically significant events are those events that occur that were highly unlikely. Statistically significant events are events that make us question the given information. If I say that women are a certain height and you think it's too low and you take a sample and you get an average that's higher and that p-value is small, that would be evidence that what I said was incorrect. There's evidence here that there was, not that there was no effect of the new drug, but that the new drug was effectiveness. And it caused that increase of that difference of 10 points or more, and it was only 1%. So the new drug, there's evidence that new drug was effectiveness. My alarm, I think, is going off. It's very quiet, though, and it is, so I must be out of time. Thank you very much. I miss you, Drew. I really appreciate you watching. Go read the book. Read the examples. Do your homework. Woo!
Bam! Oh, I had a minute and 15 seconds left. Well, I do appreciate you guys watching. If you do appreciate my efforts, maybe occasionally click on an ad if they look interesting. That helps to support my efforts. And keep coming back. I appreciate and I am honored by the privilege of helping you guys out.